Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the arrival of the official party. Also, please be aware that with the arrival of the Secretary of Defense, there will be a 19-gun salute in close proximity. If you have small children, there's going to be a lot of loud noises right outside this door in just a few minutes, so please don't be alarmed. Today's Cyboy detail is composed of members from the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps, and Canadian forces who represent NORAD and U.S. Northcom globally. Bosun, stand by to pipe the side. General, United States Air Force, arriving. NORAD and U.S. Northcom arriving. Chief of the Defense Staff arriving. Joint Chiefs arriving. Minister, National Defense, arriving. Thank you. Defense, arriving. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing and come to the position of attention while the marching on of the colors and the singing of the national anthems by the United States Air Force Academy Band. Present. Halt! NORAD and U.S. Northcom Command Chaplain Colonel Jay Johns will now give the invocation.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we're thankful for the freedom and security that we Canadians and Americans enjoy. And we're grateful for the privilege of serving as defenders of that freedom. This command stands at the forefront of national defense. This command demands exceptional leadership, and we're grateful for the way that North American Aerospace Defense Command and United States Northern Command has thrived under the principled and creative leadership of Admiral Bill Gortney. Bless the entire Gortney family as the Admiral relinquishes command today. May he complete this mission with fond memories, enduring friendships, and a strong sense of a job well done. Grant General Robinson strength, wisdom, and a keen sense of your abiding presence as she assumes the awesome responsibility of combatant command. Keep us always prepared and vigilant for the mission of national defense that you've entrusted to us. For God and country, amen.
Thank you, Chaplain. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be seated. We are honored to have a number of distinguished guests with us today. Please hold your applause until all have been recognized. Mrs. Sherry Gortney, Major General David Robinson, United States Air Force, retired. Son Travis Robinson, his wife Jackie, and their children Ethan and Maya. Son Eric Sowell, his wife Stormy, and their daughter Kylie. General Robinson's father, Colonel George Howard, United States Air Force, retired, and Lois Sullivan. General Robinson's aunt, Diana Allen. General Robinson's brother, Steve Howard, his wife Beverly, and their children. Ambassador David McNaughton, Canadian ambassador to the United States. General Salvador Cienfuegos Zepeda, Secretary of National Defense, Mexico. Admiral Vidal Francisco Soberon Sanz, Secretary of the Navy, Mexico. Mrs. Ellen Dunford, spouse of the Chairman, Joint Chiefs of Staff. Mrs. Carrie Vance, spouse of the Chief of the Defense Staff, Canada. Admiral Paul Zumkoft, Commandant, United States Coast Guard, and Mrs. Fran Donito Zumkoft. Admiral Kurt Tidd, Commander, U.S. Southern Command, and Dr. Eileen Tidd. The Honorable Senator Keith Bell, Minister of State in the Ministry of National Security, Bahamas. Mr. Eric Rosenbach, Chief of Staff, Office of the Secretary of Defense. Mr. Tom Atkin, Assistant Secretary of Defense for Homeland Defense and Global Security. Mr. Joseph Nimick, Deputy Administrator, FEMA. Chief Warrant Officer Kevin West, Canadian Forces Chief Warrant Officer. Chief Master Sergeant Mitchell Brush, Senior Enlisted Advisor to the Chief, National Guard Bureau. The Gortneys and the Robinsons are honored to have so many esteemed guests attend today's ceremony. We welcome all of you, senior leaders, active and retired, general and flag officers, community leaders, commanders, directors, senior enlisted leaders, friends and family. Thank you for attending. Ladies and gentlemen, the Commander, North American Aerospace Defense Command, and the United States Northern Command, Admiral William E. Gortney.
Is this a great day or what, huh? How about this? I'd first like to thank the soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marine, and Coast Guardsmen, and civilians who made this wonderful ceremony possible. Your hard work and professionalism set the standard for this time-honored military tradition, and I want to thank you from the bottom of all of our hearts for your efforts. I'd like to give a special shout-out to Mrs. Vicki Smith, and our head of protocol, and the team of professionals that she has, who once again have set the standard for the many events that we host here at NORAD and Northcom. Vicki and the team, Sherry and I pass our deepest thanks to all of you. Today we have a historical first, an unprecedented gathering of North American defense leadership. Here today are the U.S. Secretary of Defense, the Canadian Minister of Defense, the Mexican Secretary of National Defense, and the Secretary of the Navy, the U.S. Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the Canadian Chief of Defense Staff, the Bahamian Minister of State for National Security, and of course, the new NORAD and Northcom Commander. We also welcome to the headquarters the Canadian Ambassador to the United States. We also have my old shipmate, the Commander of U.S. Southern Command with us. Ambassador McNaughton, Secretary Carter, Minister Sajin, General Cienfuegos, Admiral Soberon, General Dunford, General Vance, Minister Bell, Admiral Tidd, and of course, my relief. Thank you for joining us here on the front range. Today's gathering provides a public opportunity to highlight the United States, Canada's, Mexico's, and Bahamas, and Southern Command's strong military-to-military relationships, and our shared interests in the defense of both North America, and it is indicative of the defense ties of our four nations and clear recognition of how far we have come and a precursor of what can be accomplished in the future. Yes, we do have differences in national priorities. All democracies do. But those differences do not impede which we share our land and our maritime borders, our history, and our future together. It is my honor to introduce the president, the presiding officer for today's ceremony, the Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Ash Carter. Now, this is the third time I've had served with and for the Secretary. The first two were in combat together in Washington, D.C., when he was the Undersecretary of Acquisition Technology and Logistics, and then our Deputy Secretary of Defense, and I was only the lowly Director of the Joint Staff. For the last 18 months, he's been my direct boss, since the Chairman is not in our chain of command, and I tell Joe Dunford that fact every single day, right after I ask him for something. Anyway, it's not always easy for a history and political science major to work for a nuclear physicist. We might be thinking from different sides of the brain, but I think that makes for a good combination, and I hope he thinks that combination works well too. In a moment, the SecDef will make some remarks, and I fear I'm about to find out. Ladies and gentlemen, our Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Ash Carter.
Thanks, Bill. Oh, somebody's glasses.
Leave them right there.
Okay. Still in command. Good boy. Says Walgreens. Well, good morning, everyone. And just look at this magnificent crowd. It makes me so proud to be here with you. My friend, Minister Sajin, General Cienfuegos, Admiral Soberon, Chairman Dunford, members of the NORAD and NORTHCOM team, friends and family, what an honor to be with you here today as we pass this critical command between two of our military's most accomplished leaders, Admiral William Gortney and General Laurie Robinson. Before I speak about the character and the contributions of these two extraordinary officers, I want to speak directly to you, to the men and women of these vital commands. In the center of our nation, you perform a mission at the center of everything we do as a department. Every day, you work across our military, across our governments, and with our closest neighbors to prepare for contingencies, to provide missile defense, keep our skies free from danger. And you're also responsible for keeping our most solemn commitment as a military to provide our citizens here at home the security they need to dream their dreams, raise their children, live full lives. Your missions here at NORAD and NORTHCOM are diverse, and challenges that you and the department face are many. In fact, today we face no fewer than five major, immediate, and evolving challenges: countering the prospect of Russian aggression and coercion, especially in Europe, managing historic change in the vital Asia-Pacific region, strengthening our deterrent and defense forces in the face of North Korea's nuclear provocations, checking Iranian aggression and malign influence in the Persian Gulf,
and accelerating the defeat of ISIL in its parent tumor in Iraq and Syria, and everywhere else it's metastasizing around the world. NORTHCOM plays a role in all of them, but this time, at this ceremony, I'd like to focus on the fifth challenge, the defeat of ISIL. ISIL not only tyrannizes the populations where it arose in Iraq and Syria, but also attempts to spread its evil ideology elsewhere. It aspires to plot or inspire attacks on Americans, including here at home. Our strategy for the lasting defeat of ISIL, therefore, is built around and will surely accomplish three objectives. One, destroying ISIL's parent tumor in Iraq and Syria. And I say lasting defeat of ISIL, because when ISIL is defeated, and it will be, it must stay defeated. This fact requires that we strengthen and enable with the vast power of the United States military and the international coalition arrayed with it, capable local forces who can seize, hold, and govern territory ISIL seized when it arose. The coalition is providing strong support for Iraqi security forces under the control of Prime Minister Abadi, who have retaken the cities of Ramadi and Heat and are making steady advances up the Euphrates River Valley. In northern Iraq, we're also supporting and enabling Iraqi forces and Kurdish forces as they begin operations to envelop Mosul, one of ISIL's two main power centers. Meanwhile, in Syria, capable and motivated local forces there, supported by the coalition, have retaken Tishrin Dam in the west and the town of Shadadi in the east. In doing so, they've cut two significant lines of communication into ISIL's stronghold of Raqqa and cut the main link from the city to ISIL's power center in Iraq, Mosul. We're also pressuring ISIL in both Iraq and Syria by systematically eliminating their so-called cabinet. We've taken out their ministers of war and finance, captured one of the architects of ISIL's chemical warfare enterprise, and most recently, we killed ISIL's military emir for Anbar province. At the same time, we're continuing attacks on ISIL's economic infrastructure, from oil wells and trucks to cash storage sites, putting a stranglehold on ISIL's ability to pay its fighters, finance its operations, and attract new recruits. In pursuit of ISIL's lasting defeat in Iraq and Syria, we have a clear plan of operations, which depends on enabling capable local forces to collapse ISIL's control, especially in their two centers of power, Mosul and Raqqa. Our accelerated campaign continues to gather strength as we support these local forces and find additional opportunities to hit ISIL in new ways. We're also addressing ISIL's metastases beyond Iraq and Syria, which is our second campaign objective. In Afghanistan, with new authorities and an added focus, we've been able to significantly degrade the group there. In Libya, we've undertaken successful strikes against a training camp and taken out ISIL's key leader of that country. Whether in the Middle East, West Africa, or South or Southeast Asia, or here in the homeland, we'll counter ISIL and work with partners wherever ISIL's has or tries to gain a foothold. Now, achieving these first two objectives against ISIL is necessary, but it's not sufficient. We must, at the same time, protect the homeland. While there's no credible imminent threat, ISIL has made its intent clear. They seek to plot or incite attacks in this country. Every day, our homeland security, intelligence, and law enforcement agencies are aggressively and skillfully working to prevent that from happening. And I want to commend FBI Director Jim Comey, Director of National Intelligence Jim Clapper, Secretary of Homeland Security Jay Johnson, and CIA Director John Brennan and others for all they're doing and for their impressive results. Protecting the homeland requires vision and collaboration across these departments and agencies. And to get to the point of this ceremony, DOD plays a vital supporting role. That's especially true at NORTHCOM, a command which was established to support homeland defense in the aftermath of September 11th. DoD supports whole-of-government efforts to protect the homeland in three critical ways. First, we're disrupting ISIL's operations and ability to conduct external attacks from abroad. Next, we're disrupting the flow of foreign fighters, both to and from Iraq and Syria. And next, we're investing resources to provide greater force protection to our troops here at home. So take the first one. DoD is pursuing a systematic effort to disrupt ISIL's external operations by removing terrorists from the battlefield who are planning, directing, or inspiring attacks against Americans. Just two weeks ago in Mosul, we killed Neil Prakash, the last remaining member of an ISIL cell calling for lone wolf attacks in this country. 1 week earlier in Syria, we also killed two more of ISIL's prominent facilitators of external attacks and recruiters of foreign fighters. Abu Saud al-Saldani and his wife, Shadi Jabbar Khalil Mohammed, both killed. Last year in Syria, we killed Junaid Hussein, a central figure in recruiting ISIL sympathizers to carry out lone wolf attacks in the West. It was also Hussein who was responsible for releasing personally identifiable information of more than 1,000 U.S. military and government employees, and who sought to inspire wannabe jihadists to conduct attacks against us in DoD. I'm in no doubt, and no one should have any doubt, those who threaten or incite harm against Americans will surely come to feel the long arm and the hard fist of justice. We will take decisive action against any ISIL member or leader planning to attack our country or encouraging others to do the same. We undertake these operations kinetically, but also through our expanding cyber mission force. While I can't discuss many of these efforts publicly, I can say that DoD's cyber capabilities are being employed in Iraq and Syria to prevent the ISIL threat from reaching the homeland. We're using these tools to deny the ability of ISIL leadership to command and finance their forces and control their populations, to identify and locate ISIL cyber actors, and to undermine the ability of ISIL recruiters to inspire or direct homegrown violent extremists. And we're also working to disrupt the flow of foreign fighters into and out of ISIL-controlled territories. Specifically, DoD is sharing what it collects from the battlefield with other domestic departments that are the leads for screening and watch listing. For instance, when we collect fingerprints from an IED in Iraq or Syria, or personal information removed from terrorists, we include this information in our biometrics-enabled watch list, which is then shared with the relevant agencies across our government. We're also fusing and sharing information and expertise across the international coalition to stem foreign fighter flows and help prevent attacks. When I met with several of my coalition counterparts last week in Germany, including my colleague from Canada, I reviewed ongoing operations to support local forces working to close the Manbij area of Syria to ISIL, which is a critical transit point for terrorists planning to execute attacks outside Iraq and Syria. Together, we must close this last entry-exit area for foreign fighters into Europe and beyond once and for all. Next, we're providing greater force protection for our troops and DoD civilians here at home. As we learned from the tragedy in Chattanooga last summer, ISIL has demonstrated a clear intent to target U.S. service members and facilities, or at least inspire others to do so. Providing greater force protection for men and women serving today is one way we honor those service members who lost their lives last August. As part of our response to those events, we're stepping up protection at bases and at the thousands of off-base installations we operate, a mission which is under Northcom's authority. We're putting in place stronger physical security systems, including stronger entry controls, better alarm systems, reinforced doors, and additional ways to safely exit our facilities. We're also introducing a mass warning and notification capability to broadcast threats quickly and broadly, notifying DoD personnel within a 20-mile radius of a threat within minutes. That's a direct response to Chattanooga, where the killer targeted two facilities 11 miles apart within the span of 12 minutes. Overall, we're investing an additional $80 million in force protection this year and an additional $100 million more over the next 2 years. At DoD, we're absolutely committed to strengthening and defending our people and facilities from potential threats of all kinds. Part of our responsibilities in military is also to keep some of the gravest threats to our people and nation at the front of our minds. While we have seen no credible evidence of a WMD threat against the homeland by any extremist group, ISIL's use of chemical weapons in Iraq underscores the importance of constant monitoring of potential threats, even remote ones. This work also connects directly to another important part of NORTHCOM's mission, which involves providing support for partners across our government, including the FBI, to prepare for extreme threats and disasters. In cases where the interests of the United States would be seriously threatened, the Department maintains a unique readiness to provide capabilities such as airlift, communications, and logistics support to federal, state, and local law enforcement. Just this month, DOD participated in a planned training exercise, NORTHCOM's Vital Archer, working with the FBI as well as other domestic agencies to enhance our preparation and integration in responding to an incident involving WMD in the homeland. The Department also stands ready to respond to chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear attacks and disasters everywhere. The DOD Chemical Radiological Nuclear Response Enterprise is comprised of National Guard and active duty forces, including 8,200 men and women under the command and control of NORTHCOM. We will continue to train, plan, and prepare for extreme circumstances when state response capabilities are exceeded and the lead federal agency requests and requires our support. As we pursue a whole-of-nation, whole-of-government effort to protect the homeland, you, the men and women of NORTHCOM, are providing steadfast support to the Department of Homeland Security and the FBI, the American people, and your families, our families, can sleep soundly knowing that you and your colleagues across our government are awake to defend and protect them. Keeping our people and nation safe and delivering ISIL a lasting defeat also depends on how effectively we work with our coalition partners. Of course, here at NORAD, our only binational command, this issue comes naturally to many of you. Whether in defeating ISIL or in defending our nation against other threats that reach across borders, our alliance with Canada is indispensable. The United States and Canada are working together every hour of every day to provide a more prosperous and secure future for the citizens of both our nations. I also want to thank our Mexican partners for their determination to expand our continental defense partnership. Mexico has become a global exporter of security, both on this continent and beyond. So I want to applaud Mexico for their growing defense relationship, and also for continuing to ensure that common values and respect for human rights are the foundation of security efforts across the hemisphere and around the world. Now, let me turn to the change of leadership for the command that performs so much of the work I've been speaking about, a change from one gifted commander to another. As commander of NORAD and NORTHCOM, Admiral Bill Gortney has been instrumental in forging stronger coordination and deeper connections with both our Mexican and our Canadian neighbors. For Bill Gortney, serving and defending this nation has been the cause of his life for the better part of four decades. With his father, who's also a naval officer and aviator, this is a commitment that runs deep in his veins. Still, Bill has said that growing up, he never intended to follow in the footsteps of his father. That all changed the first time he stepped on an aircraft carrier and heard a powerful call to serve. And because Bill Gortney has followed that call with passion and commitment ever since, our Navy is stronger, our nation's more secure. During his service as a naval aviator, he logged more than 5,000 hours piloting A-7s and F-18 Hornets. He made more than 1,200 carrier landings and flew combat missions in Iraq and Afghanistan. And after accumulating a tremendous record of success as a pilot, he transitioned seamlessly to become one of the Navy's most successful sailor statesmen. With his work to bring a diverse collection of nations together to respond to piracy in the Indian Ocean, just to take one example, he leaves a lasting legacy. By breaking down silos between the services and between partner navies, which included the Russians and the Chinese, Bill was at the center of building a formidable coalition. When he began this work, piracy off the Horn of Africa was not only a growing scourge, it was a weight on the global economy and a threat to the rules-based international order. But today, the number of large cargo and container ships seized by pirates in the region can be counted on one hand. Across continents and assignments, Bill and his wife, Sherry, have been a formidable team, building inclusive and welcoming communities wherever they've served. During two assignments in Bahrain, Bill and Sherry were critical in helping families cope with an impending separation when dependents were ordered to return home. When the order was lifted and families returned, Bill and Sherry's hospitality were instrumental in rebuilding a strong sense of community there. Several years ago, when Bill delivered the commencement address at his alma mater, Elon College, he spoke about what he had recently read on a plaque near the Statue of Liberty. They were the lines of another warrior statesman, an advocate for peace and freedom in the Americas, José Martí. The inscription read, and I quote, "Liberty costs a great price, and one must either resign oneself to live without it or decide to pay its price." Admiral Gortney, you have long understood that the price of liberty is great, and over the course of your accomplished career, you've borne it with great skill and strength. On behalf of the department, you and Sherry have our deepest appreciation for your selfless service to our nation. Thank you, Bill. And Bill, Bill, as you transition from this command, you can take comfort in knowing that NORAD and NORTHCOM are now in the hands of another proven strategic leader and warrior diplomat, General Laurie Robinson. I recommended General Robinson to the President because she has a remarkable and complete set of proven experience. Her strength as a strategic thinker and manager, which I saw firsthand during her time in the Pentagon when I worked with her closely. Her politico-military experience, most recently, and this is very important, in the critical Asia-Pacific region. And her ability to lead and command in high-tempo operational environments while putting her people first in every assignment. As a strategic thinker and joint force leader, General Robinson has proven her ability to manage complex operations and work with partners across theaters and domains. These abilities will serve our nation well as NORAD and NORTHCOM continue their vital contributions to the counter-ISIL campaign and defense of the homeland. Now, General Robinson's an Air Force weapons officer, which means she has proven her mettle by passing through one of our military's most demanding crucibles. And though Laurie passed through weapons school with flying colors, it was not only her individual success, but the shared determinations she inspired among her teammates, they say, that left another lasting impression. This ability to lead and inspire is an attribute she has carried with her to command roles in some of those difficult and complex environments. General Robinson's success as an air battle manager, a role that requires conceptualizing combat operations in a fluid, three-dimensional space, and making split-second life-or-death decisions, is another tribute to her strength as a leader. In one of the most high-pressure and high-stakes environments in our entire military enterprise, Laurie thrived. Part of her success as an air battle manager came from developing a deep knowledge of the different traditions and cultures among the different technical specialties within the Air Force. It was an experience where she learned to communicate up and down the chain of command and began to deepen her extensive politico-military skills. In her most recent tour as PACAF commander, she demonstrated these capabilities over an air of responsibility covering nearly half the globe. She was instrumental in operationalizing our important rebalance to the Pacific and in strengthening ties with air forces of some of our closest allies, including Japan, South Korea, and Australia. And while there are many leaders who played a role in bringing the Indian Air Force back to red flag, few were more instrumental than Laurie Robinson. Laurie's ability to lead, inspire, and command respect across our joint force reflects her understanding that no matter what the complexity of our platforms or the power of our technology, it's always our people who come first. the value she shares with her husband, David. He's a former Thunderbird and a retired Major General in the Air Force Reserve. Lori and David are two leaders who appreciate personally the weight of all we ask our troops and their loved ones to carry. And for many families who experienced loss, their own strength and resilience have served as an inspiration. General Robinson has described her philosophy as leadership as simply as this: leaders should be humble, approachable, and credible to those entrusted to their command. Today, she brings that spirit to the solemn responsibilities of NORAD and Northcom, and to her leadership of men and women whose success is vital to the defense of our homeland. In the days to come, we cannot predict precisely how and when the men and women of NORAD and Northcom will be called forward to carry their mission. But we do know this. We know General Robinson will lead this team with certainty, clarity, and with the full trust and confidence of me and the President. We know that as our military works with partners across our government and across our continent, NORAD and NORTHCOM's efforts will be essential in providing security for our people and our nation. And we know this with absolute certainty: the force General Robinson inherits is ready to execute its vital responsibilities thanks to Admiral Gortney's leadership. To Admiral Gortney, to General Robinson, to all the men and women who have served under their strong and steady leadership, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure that I now introduce the Honorable Harjeet Sajjan, the Minister of National Defense of Canada.
Secretary Carter, General Dunford, General Vance, Admiral Gortney, General Robinson, ambassadors, honored guests. I'm honored to represent the Government of Canada as we bid farewell to Admiral Bill Gortney and welcome General Lori Robinson as NORAD Commander. Since its inception in 1958, NORAD has been the first line of defense for air attacks against our two countries. In 1961, shortly after NORAD was established, President John F. Kennedy spoke to the Canadian Parliament and succinctly captured the nature of U.S.-Canada relationships as follows. Geography has made us neighbors. History has made us friends. Economics has made us partners. Necessity has made us allies. 55 years later, that description still rings true. We are still each other's greatest trading partners and allies in defense. While the geography has remained the same, we have added over half a century of common history since President Kennedy uttered those famous words. Unfortunately, much of this recorded history tends to deal with conflict, a subject we all know too well. Although what receives less attention are the models of cooperation, when nations, institutions, and individuals work together. NORAD is certainly a shining example of two countries can and continue to work together for mutual benefit. The international security environment in 2016 differs greatly from what our countries faced in 1958. Global terrorism is now an almost daily fact of life. Local and regional conflicts can quickly flare up and trigger major international events. In this century, North America is no longer a remote island of safety. So our vigilance must remain intense. We must continue to adapt to new threats. Admiral Gortney, you have been instrumental in ensuring our two countries understood how these changes impact North American defense and NORAD missions. You have served our two countries with great distinction. Thank you for your loyal and dedicated service. May you enjoy whatever new adventures retirement holds in store. I would also like to welcome General Robinson in her new role as commander of NORAD. Her impressive career with the U.S. Air Force speaks volumes to her skills and abilities. Most recently, she was responsible for Air Force activities spread over half the globe as commander of the Pacific Air Force. General Robinson, there is no doubt that these and the other impressive roles you have occupied over the years have prepared you well to assume these new responsibilities. As we welcome General Robinson as NORAD commander, we offer our sincere gratitude to Admiral Gortney. While there is change in NORAD command, the mission remains the same. And we Canadians will continue to work alongside our U.S. partners to monitor and defend North American airspace and watch our maritime approaches. May history record, reflect, and remember our unique partnership. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated for the presentation of the award. The Chairman, Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Dunford, will now present the Defense Distinguished Service Medal to Admiral Gortney. Admiral William E. Gortney, United States Navy, distinguished himself by exceptionally distinguished service as Commander, North American Aerospace Defense Command and United States Northern Command from December 2014 to May 2016. Admiral Gortney challenged the commands to look beyond traditional borders and missions to defend North America from ever-evolving threats. Under his leadership and vision, the most enduring binational command in the history of the United States military began to redefine its mission for the future, enhancing the bonds that have secured the skies above the homelands for 60 years. Admiral Gortney's visionary leadership led to conversations on strengthening the unique relationship between the United States and Canada and increased military-to-military training and interaction with Mexico and the Bahamas. Within the homeland, Admiral Gortney's keen intuition led to a deliberate campaign plan to protect United States forces from the threat of homegrown violent extremists. Admiral Gortney led Department of Defense planning to support lead federal agencies to minimize the threat of both the Ebola and Zika viruses. The distinctive accomplishments of Admiral Gortney culminate a long and distinguished career in the service of his country and reflect great credit upon himself, the United States Navy, and the Department of Defense. At this time, we would like to ask Mrs. Sherry Gortney to join General Dunford and Admiral Gortney on the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated for the presentation of the award. General Dunford is presenting Mrs. Gortney with the Distinguished Public Service Award, and it reads, in recognition of distinguished public service and significant contributions toward improving the quality of lives for sailors, service members, and their families from 1 July 1980 to 13 May 2016. Having been a Navy spouse for more than 36 years, Mrs. Gortney is profoundly cognizant and supportive of the service of military spouses and the sacrifices of families, especially during the last 15 years of war. Sherry has been a pillar of strength for countless Gold Star spouses, parents, families, and communities that have lost a loved one in service to their nation in the Iraq and Afghanistan conflicts. She wholeheartedly supported our wounded warriors through many events and fundraisers. While her husband led Navy forces to meet operational requirements at the Fleet Forces Command during a period of budget constraints and sequestration, Sherry was the stitch that held the cloth of our nation, Navy, and our families together. She was the ultimate ambassador during engagements with foreign dignitaries throughout the Middle East and North America. Her compassion was unsurpassed as she led a fundraising initiative for the Casa de la Mercedes in Mexico City, providing needed support to care and house 70 abused adolescent females. The distinctive accomplishments of Mrs. Gortney are in keeping with the finest traditions of public service and reflect great credit upon herself, the United States Navy, and the Department of Defense. Once again, thank you, Mrs. Gortney. At this time, General Vance will present Admiral Gortney with the Meritorious Service Cross. The Meritorious Service Cross recognizes a military deed or activity that has been performed in an outstandingly professional manner, according to a rare high standard that brings considerable benefit or great honor to the Canadian Armed Forces and to Canada. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated. The citation reads, Meritorious Service Cross, Admiral William E. Gortney, United States Navy. As commander of North American Aerospace Defense Command and United States Northern Command from 2014 to 2016, Admiral Gortney's devotion to duty and selfless service to both Canada and the United States contributed immeasurably to a strong, integrated, binational defense of North America. His initiative to redefine the defensive plans of North America by eliminating gaps and seams, realigning command and control structures, and advocating for a combined continental defense ultimately strengthened North American defense and security. General Vance, you may be seated. Well done, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct honor to introduce Admiral William E. Gortney, Commander, North American Aerospace Defense Command and United States Northern Command.
Big shout out for our narrator. I think he's ready to be the narrator of the Blue Angels. Myself. Thank you, Chairman and Chief, for those awards. They represent the incredible work of the professionals who work for both our nations. Now, I'd be remiss if I did not recognize the professionals from Mexico as well. 2 weeks ago in Mexico City, General Cienfuegos and Admiral Soberon presented me with the Secretary of National Defense for Mexico Military Merit First Class and the Secretary of Mexican Navy Naval Distinction Second Class. Now those awards too represent the efforts of the soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen and our civilians from both the U.S. and Mexico. And I am humbled and honored to wear all four awards. My deepest thanks. Now today really is a great day. And yesterday was also a great day as we celebrated NORAD's birthday. 58 years ago, during the Cold War, Canada and the United States signed the agreement creating the unique binational command, the only one of its kind in the globe. And in the decade since, we have watched the skies over Canada and the United States together. Just outside this hangar, we have a great view of Cheyenne Mountain, and it's in the distance. The vast bunker complex within Cheyenne Mountain was also created during the Cold War and is perhaps the most notable symbol of the command. We also keep the aliens there. For decades, from within that mountain, NORAD defended North America against the threat of Soviet manned bombers. After the fall of the Soviet Union, the bear went into hibernation. Today, however, as Russian aggression in Eastern Europe and Syria and in the air and maritime approaches to North America demonstrates, the bear woke up. The threat is changing. Russia has resurged, China's military is advancing, and North Korea and Iran continue their bad behavior. North America is no longer protected by distance and oceans. The standoff long enjoyed has eroded. New technology and connectivity, you know what the word I'm looking for, have given both state and non-state actors, terrorists, and criminal networks the ability to reach us both militarily and asymmetrically. While NORAD was born of the Cold War, United States Northern Command was born of 9/11. Northcom arose because of those who spew hatred and claim a religious ideology to spread terror will not cease to endanger our homeland and those of our partners. These evolving threats require our approach to the defense of North America and the defense relationship of our four great nations to evolve also. And this is why the presence of Canadian, Mexican, Bahamian, and U.S. defense leadership here today is so important. Since 1940, the defense relationship between the Canada and the U.S. has evolved to address new threats and must continue to evolve in order to meet the challenges of the 21st century. General Vance, Minister of Defense, thank you for your support in this critical effort. General Cienfuegos, Admiral Soberon, I am grateful for our friendship and the strengthened partnerships with Sedena and Samar that we enjoy here at Northern Command. You have been asked to do a very tough mission, and you are in a long fight with immense challenges. And I am confident our military relationships will continue evolving to meet the changing threats to both of our homelands. Minister Bell, just this week, SOC North finished working with the Bahamian Defense Force on a shared defense exercise of significant importance to both our nations. The exercise started in the Bahamas and is currently being completed here in the U.S., and we look forward to more shared opportunities to make our nations safer. From this hangar to the north of Cheyenne Mountain, we can also see Pikes Peak, which stands as a stunning backdrop over this great city of Colorado Springs. The view from the top of Pikes Peak inspired Catherine Lee Bates to write the lyrics to America the Beautiful. And many of you know the first verse of that patriotic hymn by heart, but I want to highlight a line from the third stanza, which reads the following. Confirm thy soul in self-control, thy liberty in law. Now, Bates didn't know it when she wrote those words in 1893, but they apply well to the Northcom's mission of defense support to civil authorities, or what we shorten up to DISCA. In DISCA missions, Northcom is not in charge, which can be an adjustment for certain short type A folks new to the command. Rather, we must exercise self-control and follow the domestic rule of law in supporting the lead federal agency, most often our closest mission partner, the Department of Homeland Security. Now, Admiral Zumkopf, Mr. Rosen, Mr. Nimick, Joe, thank you for being here today and for being such great mission partners. Please pass my best to Secretary Johnson, or as I like to call him, the judge, which is a term of endearment we in the Navy give our lawyers. We also have great partners in the National Guard in each of our states, where again, Northcom is not in charge, but stands ready to support our governors of this great nation. Together, our teams move the ball down the field and preparing for what we call weather of mass destruction events and other crisis events in the homeland. Regarding such events, may we continue to be over-prepared and under-employed. The Northcom staff evolved our command and control structure to better support the lead federal agencies, as well as states during such events by creating internally a joint task force for this very purpose. I'm proud of the staff of NORAD and Northcom for all of their hard work, and I'm grateful to the 60 interagency and law enforcement partners who are embedded within our command structure. Their critical presence in this headquarters is what sets Northern Command apart from our fellow COCOMs. I'm also appreciative of the support of our Northcom component commands and NORAD regions, region commanders. Thanks for attending today. The reason we stand ready to defend the homeland or respond to a crisis, of course, is to protect the homelands and take care of our fellow citizens. Now, I'm going to shift gears and talk of family. For the past for the first time in 39 years, I'm placing family in front of nation and Navy. Now, my dad turned 92 years old, and it was a long way for him to go, to come out here. But my goal in life has to be, read the words, half the naval officer and naval aviator and half the husband, father, and grandfather that he is. Now, I'll soon have more time to support him in that effort. My thanks to my sisters, Linda and Candy, and their husbands, Hal and Greg, for looking after Dad. And Sherry and I can't wait to step into that role. Now, our son, Billy, and his wife, Jackie, Stephanie, our daughter, and our grandsons, Gavin and Grayson, well, they're in Virginia, too, where Sherry and I will soon join them, and she's really excited about it. In a few short months, Stephanie will continue in the Navy tradition in our family when she marries a fine young naval officer, Lieutenant Sean Ryan. Now, he's a naval flight officer. No fighter pilot ever dared walk into my home, but this kid did. Now, we look forward to welcoming him into our family, although I really don't look forward to paying for the wedding. Now, my own time on the water is going to be focused on teaching Gavin and grandson how to water ski. Sherry, thanks. That's as much as I can say. Now, Sherry and I have been lucky to call Colorado Springs and the Front Range home for the last year and a half, and we've been blown away by the heartfelt support to the military that we've witnessed here. Our deepest thanks to the terrific community for your support to the members of NORAD and Northcom, as well as to our soldiers at Fort Carson, to the airmen here at Pete and at Schriever, and to the cadets up at the Air Force Academy. Now, this is my 14th change of command, counting both incoming and outgoing, and I'm here to tell you the incoming is far more enjoyable and far more meaningful. One only has to look at the number of family attending the event today. As outgoing, it's just Sherry and myself, but we're going to go pretty deep and count Roger Welsh and Brick Nelson and Don and Disney Stevenson and, of course, the Mucklows as family today because they, well, they really are. Yet the entire Robinson clan is in here to witness Lori take command of these two great commands. And if I could, would the whole clan stand up so everybody can see this incredible effort that you put into the airline industry? Sherry just said something. What was it, sweetie? Oh, and Senior Chief. Where's Senior Chief? There's Senior Chief, family too. Everybody understands the cake boss. Thank you, sweetie. You know, people ask, what's it like to be a four-star admiral? And I usually say, I'm a handsome and powerful man. I command ships, airplanes, submarines, battalions. Do what I want. Except for when I get home, Sherry says, take out the trash. Okay. Now, I said when I took command here that the Denver Broncos would now be our football team. Now, perhaps I can't take all the credit, but they did win the Super Bowl 50 in the next full season after my arrival. I'll let you all decide whether it was a mere coincidence. At the incoming speech, I displayed my Broncos mug, and now I have a new mug honoring their Super Bowl victory. And Lori, don't say I haven't given you anything. Finally, to all the members of NORAD and NORTHCOM, soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marine, Coast Guardsmen, civilians, shipmates. I wish to thank every member of the NORAD and NORTHCOM team, but I want to really thank your families for their sacrifice and the contributions each of them make. While we wear the cloth of our nations, it is our families that are the very stitches that hold that cloth together. You and your families can proudly say that you are part of a few, a band of patriots from the greatest nations in the world. Two commands who together stand proudly in execution of one common purpose. You stand the watch, ready to respond, ready to protect our homelands. I am proud to have served with each and every one of you. God bless each and every one of you. I will now read my orders. pursuant to the provisions of Title 10, U.S. Code 1370 and 6322, detach on 13 May 2016 from duty as Commander, United States Northern Command, Commander, North American Defense Command, relieved of all active duty effective 2359, 31 May 2016. Master Chief, strike my flag.
In keeping with Navy tradition, Fleet Master Chief will haul down Admiral Gortney's personal flag. The use of the star to signify the rank of flag officer can be traced to a June 1780 decree by General George Washington during the War of American Independence. The star is the oldest continually used rank in the United States military. Since 1866, there have only been 221 four-star Navy admirals. Admiral Gortney is number 213. Admiral Tidd, who's with us today, is our latest. The flag now being presented is Admiral Gortney's personal colors. This flag has flown outside the NORAD and U.S. Northcom headquarters every day of his command, letting all who entered know that Admiral Gortney had the watch.
General Robinson, I'm ready to be relieved.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated as we commence the change of command ceremonies. General Vance is the presiding official for the North American Aerospace Defense Command change of command. Assisting will be Fleet Master Chief Terrence Molador, the NORAD and U.S. Northcom senior enlisted leader. General Vance. By direction of the President of the United States and the Prime Minister of Canada, Admiral William E. Gortney relinquishes command of the North American Aerospace Defense Command effective 13 May 2016. General Laurie J. Robinson is directed to assume command of the North American Aerospace Defense Command effective 13 May 2016. General Vance, you may be seated. The presiding official for the United States Northern Command, change of command, is the Honorable Ashton B. Carter, the United States Secretary of Defense. By direction of the President of the United States, Admiral William E. Gortney relinquishes command of the United States Northern Command, effective 13 May 2016. General Laurie J. Robinson is directed to assume command of the United States Northern Command, effective 13 May 2016. Secretary Carter. Thank you, sir. Secretary Carter, Admiral Gortney, you may be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct privilege to introduce General Laurie J. Robinson, Commander, North American Aerospace Defense Command and United States Northern Command.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, and you are doing an incredible job, really. First of all, I'd like to thank all who made this incredible ceremony possible and for making this time-honored military tradition so special for Team Gortney and Team Robinson. We really do appreciate it. I'd like to also thank President Obama and Prime Minister Trudeau for the privilege and the honor of serving as the 24th Commander of NORAD and the 7th Commander of U.S. Northern Command. I'd also like to thank Secretary Carter, Minister Sajjan, Chairman Dunford, General Vance, Secretary James, and General Welsh for their trust and confidence in selecting me to lead these critical commands at a time when regional and global events pose increasingly serious challenges to the international community and to our own national security. Leading NORAD and U.S. Northern Command is a significant responsibility, and I pledge that I will do this and devote my full energy and focus on this job. I'd like to recognize a few international friends and partners: Ambassador McNaughton, General Sofuegos, Admiral Sobran, Minister Bell. We sincerely appreciate the support you've provided to our fellow citizens in the past, and I look forward to working with you and together with our nations. In the coming weeks and months, I'm excited to travel to Canada, Mexico, and the Bahamas and build upon the great personal relationships that Admiral Gortney and our predecessors developed and nurtured over time. And I'm actually also looking very forward to sampling some of our Canadian members' moose milk recipes. I did hear that the NORAD deputy's office had the top recipe last Christmas. Undeniably, the power and the strength of NORAD and U.S. Northern Command is derived from its sustained partnerships with joint, interagency, and multinational organizations. This is best represented by the fact that nearly 60 DOD and non-DOD federal agencies, department representatives, and liaison officers are integrated into the headquarters. Admiral Zumkoff, Admiral Davidson, Admiral Tidd, Mr. Rosen, Mr. Nimick, thank you for joining us today, and thank you for being excellent mission partners. I look forward to closely working with you and fellow combatant commanders, service chiefs, the National Guard Bureau, reserve components, state governors, the Canadian Joint Operations Command, and our interagency teammates. To all of David and my new friends here in Colorado, we are so excited to be here. I want to thank you for your unflagging support you have given to our military members and their families. These patriots are motivated by duty, honor, and a call to service. So thank you so much for supporting them and recognizing the invaluable role they play in safeguarding our nation and our way of life. We look forward to the mission ahead and becoming a part of this phenomenal Colorado Springs community. Now, I have to admit a couple of things. When I looked out this morning and saw the beautiful sunrise and the amazing, beautiful Pikes Peak, I had to wonder what that white stuff was on the top of it. But I'm going to work on to see if cowboy boots go with Aloha wear. That's kind of my idea. And, you know, and Admiral Gortney was showing me the antennas and showing me Cheyenne Mountain, and he whispered to me and he said, "That's where the aliens are." And I said, "Cool, I can't wait to meet them." To my father, George Howard, you are the man. Thank you for your 30 years of service to the Air Force, and thank you for being an incredible role model. I've looked up to you my entire life. To my aunts, uncles, brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews, Travis and Eric, spouse Jackie and Stormy, grandchildren Ethan, Maya, and Kylie. Yes, Kylie, yes. I have to tell you, of all my favorite duty titles, they kind of range with Mom, Sis, Aunt Lo, and the favorite, I am Gigi. To my husband, David, you are the love of my life, and I certainly would not be here without your unwavering love, and you're the rock. You have been incredible support for me in these last years and our entire marriage, and I wouldn't know what to do without you, and I'm so grateful we're here together doing this. Thank you. Team Gortney. Team Gortney, it is so exciting to share this stage and this day with you. We know that you both have put your heart and soul into your time in command because that's just how you are. Bill, thank you for your outstanding leadership, 39 years of dedicated service to our nation. You have guided NORAD and U.S. Northern Command to such high levels of excellence. Your commitment to the security of the United States, Canada, and our allies has been just tremendous, and I appreciate the flight path that you left me with. Thank you so much. As mentioned previously, the world is more dangerous and North America is increasingly vulnerable to a vast array of evolving threats. Threats in every domain we operate in. Threats are becoming more diffuse and less attributable. Yes, we face an increasingly complex security environment, but as President Kennedy once said, our problems are man-made, and therefore they may be solved by man. No problem of human destiny is beyond human beings. With linkages in our cultures, our prosperity, and our security, the quality and scope of cooperation between the United States, Canada, and Mexico is at an unprecedented high. This gathering today is of the highest defense leadership of North America, not only highlights how far we've come together, but signals the bright future of what is still to come from our three nations. With shared borders, interests, history, and most importantly, a shared future, our robust security relationships are paramount to addressing an evolving security landscape and transnational threats. With our Canadian partners, I appreciate our long storied history of military cooperation, one that actually extends back to the days prior to World War II. For almost 6 decades, NORAD has been a model for international cooperation and a symbol of trust and confidence between the United States and Canada. Truly, it is a unique and special organization, and I am proud to be a part of it. I'm encouraged by the growth in defense ties between the United States and Mexico and aspire to elevate these new heights. And let's not forget our important partner in the eastern flank, the Bahamas. I look forward to working with you. As a military leader, I will never forget that my greatest responsibility is to defend our homelands and to protect their people, national powers, and freedom of action. I will work passionately to uphold the faith the American and Canadian people have placed in these commands and ensure that we remain vigilant and postured to outpace any potential threat. Because our partners are the center of gravity, I vow to continue developing these strong relationships with our homeland partners so we are always prepared to provide defense support to federal, state, and local authorities as requested when the American people need it the most. Let me end by saying how much I appreciate the opportunity to continue serving alongside the world's best airmen, soldiers, sailors, Marines, Coast Guardsmen, National Guardsmen, reservists, civilians, and the families. You've safeguarded our nation's most diverse and challenging security atmosphere in history. Thank you for your vigilance, your dedication, and your hard work. And you know now, we have a sacred responsibility. I started my career as an air battle manager on the E-3, and I always loved the fact that it was the E-3 sentry. Watch, as you know, a soldier stationed to keep watch and to keep guard. Truly, I relished this opportunity to execute these missions with you, and alongside you, I accept the watch. God bless our great nations, and God bless you all.
Thank you, General, and welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the departure of the official party. Bosun, host the side boys. Mr. Secretary, you may proceed. Defense, departing. Minister, National Defense, departing. Joint Chiefs, departing. Chief of the Defense Staff, departing. Admiral and Mrs. Gortney, departing. NORAD and U.S. Northcom and Major General Robinson, departing. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the change of command ceremony. The men and women of NORAD and U.S. Northcom wish Admiral Gortney and Mrs. Gortney the very best in their next chapter. You are cordially invited to attend a reception welcoming General Robinson and Major General Robinson at the Peterson Club immediately following the ceremony.